a Japanese-funded bluefin tuna expedition that went on every year and is still going on now. I started on that in 2005, and it was an 18-day survey between Esperance and Albany. This is halfway. And one of the lines, the transect lines that we would do, went near this location off Bremer. And I just noticed more life there than usual. Sometimes killer whales, sometimes birds, oceanic sunfish, different animals congregating in this location. A few years before I started on the tuna expedition, I was working for the CSIRO's Animal Ethics Division on their white shark satellite tagging program. And we went to a location not far from here, and there was a sperm whale stranding. 9 animals came ashore, lots of white sharks turned up, and we managed to get a satellite tag on one of the animals. And 3 months later, the tag surfaced. And ultimately, we worked out that that animal was eaten by something with an internal temperature of 27 degrees out here. It recorded water temperatures of like 27 degrees Celsius at 580 meters, which is ridiculous. it's not real.
Yeah.
So the scientists in Hobart, who were looking at this summary of this information that was uploading via satellite, decided that it was a faulty tag. And after 7 days of drifting back this way and sending through information, the batteries went flat and the tag died.
Yeah.
So they filed it away. And just, well, that's the end of that. In order to get all of the information, you need to find the tag.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
2 weeks later, a guy's walking along the beach, the same beach we tagged it at, and found the tag.
Whoa.
He sent it to the CSIRO in Hobart, and the first thing they did was notice that it was white. It's been in the ocean on the back of a shark for 3 months. It should be covered in algae.
Yeah, yeah. It was like...
It looked like it had been in stomach acid.
Yeah.
They then plugged it into the computer and realised that this shark, after we tagged it, had swum up to Ningaloo Reef.
Yeah, or up north.
Up north, like 1,500 kilometres north of Perth, 300 nautical miles out to sea, where it intercepted the bluefin tuna migration, no doubt, back down the coast, was eaten out here.
Whoa.
The thing that ate it swam out into the Great Australian Bight, excreted it, and the tag then washed up on the same beach.
Wow.
Get a load of that.
Wow.
That's true. That's what happened.
Wow.
Bizarre.
Yeah, yeah.
It could have washed up anywhere.
Yeah.
Wow. Same beach, 4 nautical miles east from where we tagged
it. Wow.
And then I noticed the oil and gas industry conducting a survey out there, and I managed to get hold of all of their results, their marine mammal observers data. They had 2 people on the boat looking at animals, and what they saw during that 44-day survey lined up with what I thought I was seeing out there. They basically corroborated what I thought I was seeing. They were seeing animals in the same rough location as well. And then I managed to get hold of their seismic data, and that showed that there is indeed a commercial quantity of oil and gas out there, and some of those oil and gas systems are leaking. And it seemed that these huge slicks on the surface that we see periodically of Trichodesmia bacteria and phytoplankton are actually getting their nutrition from these leaking hydrocarbons. So we thought, hang on, if you drill a hole in this and depressurize these systems, you may cause the collapse of this entire South Coast ecosystem. That's what it's all about. So I was mentioning this fact to my contacts within the Australian government, and there was absolutely no traction whatsoever. So I thought the last ditch effort to draw attention to this was to make a film about it. But how do I make a film?
Okay.
So I coupled those two stories together, as in, here's this mystery of a shark that was eaten by a mystery predator in this location, and the film went crazy, and we subsequently made another film for Discovery Channel 2 years ago, and we've managed to get expeditions happening on the back of those two films, and now we've taken, I think, around 3,000 or 4,000 people out to see this location, and the oil and gas industry have gone. So, you know, the different sorts of animals we see out there, it's not just limited to killer whales, it's the whole system that we're looking at. It's like, you know, killer whales are the big ticket item. They're the things that people pay money for get on the boat. But by taking people out to see the killer whales, they're effectively providing us with a platform to examine the whole ecosystem and to try and work out the system. How does this work?
Yeah.
How is oil and gas related to this system, if at all? By having, you know, we're doing over 100 days out there this year, and we can see the system change from week to week.
Yeah.
You know, it seems that the Lewin current weakens. That's our principal current in Western Australia.
Yeah.
And at this time of the year, it weakens,
allowing
an upwelling to pick up all of these nutrients being generated by the hydrocarbon system and push it to the surface.
Okay.
And when that happens, that basically stimulates Trichodesmia bacteria to flourish.
Okay, true Trichodesmia. Okay.
Trichodesmia,
okay.
And it basically grabs nitrogen from the atmosphere and turns it into a form that phytoplankton can use. And then phytoplankton, of course, are the very beginning, the building blocks. The nutrients that are coming up, like oil and gas, which has been shown to be happening, as well as methane. The squid are attracted to these methane hydrate reef systems. This is part of the idea, because they're loaded with crabs and prawns and shrimps and all sorts of things that squid eat. So the beaked whales are very acoustic. They're the most sensitive mammal there is, the deepest diving mammal, and very sensitive. They're listening for the sound of methane leaking.
Whoa.
And that is what they target. That's how they find the squid. So the killer whales are up the top looking for the beaked whales surfacing. And now that's just rolling on. We've missed the killer whales for the last couple of days.
Okay.
And we were wondering why. Why aren't they in the hot spot anymore where the beaked whales are? And we've noticed today, sperm whales are everywhere. They're just turning up now.
Whoa.
So it seems they're shifting strategy.
Oh, okay, yeah.
They've moved where they are. So we found them today, the cheeky little buggers.
Whoa.
They're looking at the calves. But what they're also looking at is the bull sperm whales. The bull sperm whale will come through first.
Okay.
He's diving in the deep waters about 1,200 metres somewhere. And then the following day, his herd comes through, the females and the calves. But what happens is, he dives down, he grabs a squid, the killer whales are listening to him, echolocating. When he stops echolocating, they know he's coming to the surface with his giant squid. These things are up by 400 kilograms, they're huge. The killer whales then try to steal the squid from him.
Easy.
Yeah, it's classic.
Yeah, it
is so cool to see.
Yeah.
You know, we saw the aftermath of that today, and we saw it in 2014 as well.
Wow.
Which is crazy.
Yeah.
You know, it's like we call it the aquatic Jurassic Park.
It sounds like.
Yeah, so you can see the whole season changing, and then as the Lewin current starts to pick up in April, May, the killer whales all step out of it.
Yeah.
So now we've got a much bigger boat. We're able to push into the sperm whale migration, and no one's looked at the numbers of sperm whales since whaling finished in 1978.
Wow.
You know, this is pretty important sort of stuff.
Yeah, very important.